Audible Inc. presents The Dragonfly Effect, written by Jennifer Aaker and Andy Smith, narrated by Andy Smith.
Focused, concrete goal. In the past 10 years, social networking technologies have revolutionized the way we communicate and collaborate online. Each day, over 175 million of us log into Facebook. Each minute, 20 hours of video is uploaded to YouTube. Each second, over 600 tweets are tweeted out onto the web to a worldwide audience. And these numbers are growing exponentially. If we use these avenues for social change, what kind of difference could we make? How many people could we get involved? What kind of impact could we have on an individual, a corporation, or the world? Our mission is to show you how to harness the power of social media for social good by blending the theory underlying social change and the applications of social media. Our approach, which we call the Dragonfly Effect, coalesces the focal points of our distinct careers, research and insights on consumer psychology and happiness, what really makes people happy as opposed to what they think makes them happy, with the practical approaches necessary to capture these effects. Over the past several years, we've each benefited from each other's very different perspective. Let's just say one of us didn't get Twitter, and the other doubted the place of feelings in organizations. By joining forces, we've been able to provide individuals and corporations with insights into social technology, tools to unlock the spreading of ideas, and the ability to incite infectious action. Our capacity to predict seemingly irrational responses has improved both brands and bottom lines. Most recently, our blended perspectives culminated in a course, The Power of Social Technology, at the Stanford Graduate School of Business. In the Power of Social Technology class, students adopt design thinking mindsets and creative processes with the help of an ecosystem of collaborators, including top Silicon Valley entrepreneurs, investors, and the Hasso-Plattner Institute of Design at Stanford. The class proved more successful and inspirational than we could have ever anticipated. Not only did it demonstrate that people are clamoring for ways to use social media for social good, but it confirmed our belief that there is a replicable framework that will allow them to execute their goals efficiently and effectively and achieve meaningful change. Many of us have experienced how social technologies are changing the way people relate to each other. They allow us to connect with old friends and make new ones, share our interests with a broad network of people, and communicate efficiently, often instantaneously. But we are only beginning to understand how these same technologies can fundamentally shift how we engage with and inspire all these networked people and empower them to participate in global movements for change. This book will tell these emerging stories. Regardless of the change you seek to affect in the world, whether it is to inspire others to join your social movement, mobilize political change, or simply satisfy an individual need, consider this your playbook for moving your cause from awareness to action. The introduction. Why reading this book is worth the investment. A dizzying number of people have written about the mechanics of Facebook, Twitter, email, and YouTube, yet few have addressed one of our strongest motivations, how to leverage the power of the new social media to do something that really matters. The dragonfly is the only insect able to propel itself in any direction with tremendous speed and force when its four wings are working in concert. This ancient, exotic, and benign creature illuminates the importance of integrated effort. It also demonstrates that small actions can create big movements. To us, the dragonfly effect is the elegance and efficacy of people who, through their passionate pursuit of goals, discover that they can make a positive impact disproportionate to their resources. We've been lucky enough to learn from such people and to profile their efforts here. Most of us are inundated daily with articles, emails, videos, and blog posts. Invitations to participate in compelling social campaigns have become ubiquitous, from Avon's Walk for Breast Cancer to Pepsi's Refresh campaign to general pleas to help save our planet. Yet we glaze over and ignore many, if not most, of these pleas. Or perhaps we join a group, but take no real action on behalf of the cause. Anyone who has ever created a YouTube video, written a blog, or tried to get someone to join a cause on Facebook knows that simply sending out a request doesn't guarantee results. Yet the power of social technology, when fully engaged, can be nothing short of revolutionary. Just this year, the Red Cross raised more than $30 million for Haiti relief through text message donations. The same technologies that enable us to poke our friends or retweet an interesting article are the ones that can connect us and mobilize us to bring about change. So, what differentiates those who are harnessing social media for something more powerful than fun or procrastination? It's clear from our research and teaching that promoting a personal goal, in contrast to what you may think, is inherently social. To be successful, you must translate your passion into a powerful story and tell it in a way that generates contagious energy, so your audience reflects on your tweet, blog post, or email long after they leave their computers. By doing this, you generate participation, networking, growth, and ripple effects, forces which combine to form a movement that people feel they are a part of. Your personal goal then becomes collective. Drawing on underlying truths found in psychological research, the Dragonfly Effect provides a framework to show you how to do this. In these pages, we will teach you four key skills: focus, grab attention, engage, and take action, which you will use to produce your own colossal results. And we will reveal the secret to cultivating stickiness so that your goal is not relegated to internet oblivion, but instead reaches an audience of people who will help propel it forward. The other reason to read this book is that it might help you become a happier person. Research on happiness makes it clear that happiness in and of itself is a bogus conceit. What people think makes them happy, moving to sunny California, getting a promotion at work, taking a trip to Disneyland, does not. In fact, the happiest people are those who have stopped chasing happiness and instead search for meaningfulness, a change in direction that leads to sustainable happiness, the kind that actually enriches their lives. Why is happiness so elusive? One reason is that the definition of happiness changes every 3 to 5 years throughout one's life. The meaning of happiness is not idiosyncratic, individualistic, or random, nor is it singular and stable. Happiness has a clear pattern, indicating that people are pursuing different things across their lifespans. For example, from ages 25 to 30, roughly, money is linked to happiness. After that, money becomes decoupled from happiness, and meaningfulness starts to outshine it in importance. No matter what age you are now, you will at some point be looking for meaningfulness. Although most people still believe that creating meaning or greater good in the world doesn't align with profit-making, we have seen many people and organizations that created a golden quadrant, aligning the work they love with a profit-oriented business model, go on to become much stronger, more sustainable, and able to generate more social good. Dragonfly Mini Case Study, Gap's Give and Get Program. Gap Inc. was one of the first retailers to extend discount privileges to employees, friends, and families on special occasions throughout the year. Although originally a fresh idea, these friends and family days soon became ubiquitous throughout the industry. Gap wanted to stand out. It also wanted to get back to its roots as an involved and caring member of the communities it did business in. In the words of founder Doris Fitcher, Gap should become a store with a heart. Enter Give and Get. Give and Get is an innovative and sustainable web-based cause marketing program that offers participants substantial discounts on Gap Inc. products, with a portion of each sale going to a designated charity or nonprofit. Employees and customers get invited to Give and Get events in which they receive coupons they can redeem online or at any Gap Inc. brick-and-mortar retail store: Gap, Old Navy, Banana Republic, outlet stores, and Piper Lime. Donations are tracked through unique barcodes in the invitation. And one of the unique features of the program is that its direction is driven by employees and customers. They choose the nonprofit partners they want to support, and in turn their friends and family members are shopping to support their cause. This has resulted in a tremendous commitment to the program. The results are impressive. Gap Inc. estimates donations through Give and Get to reach $10 million by the first quarter of 2010. This is accounted for by a concept known as the ripple effect. In economics, the ripple effect is used to show how an individual's increase in spending increases the incomes of others and their subsequent ability to spend. In sociology, it describes how social interactions can affect situations indirectly. In charitable activities, the ripple effect explains how information can be disseminated and passed from community to community to broaden its impact. In the Dragonfly Effect, we describe it as the simple idea that small acts can create big change. Our general research in this area shows that ripple effects result from small actions that have a positive, significant impact on others and over time. When the action at the epicenter of the ripple effect is based on deep meaning, or something that you believe will make you happy in both a profound and long-lasting way, a multiplier effect occurs. Time can psychologically expand when people are doing something they love and the process of doing it makes them happy. In those conditions, people actually feel that they have more hours in the day and are more likely to enjoy what they're doing in the moment. Think of the adage, time flies when you're having fun. In such conditions, others around you feel the emotion that you're feeling and can therefore become more strongly mobilized. This phenomenon is emotional contagion, the tendency to feel emotions similar to and influenced by those of others. One view, developed by the psychologist John Cacioppo and his colleagues, is that emotional contagion can be physically manifested by the tendency to unconsciously mimic and synchronize facial expressions, postures, and movements with those of another person and consequently to converge emotionally. Research has shown that babies often mimic the behaviors of their mothers. People who live with each other for a long period of time grow physically similar in their facial features by virtue of repeated empathic mimicry. A leader's emotional state can impact the rapport, morale, and even the performance of a team. In fact, something as innocuous as the emotional tonality of someone's voice, happy versus sad, can affect how much listeners like the message. Even more interestingly, in a study of more than 4,700 people who were followed over 20 years, researchers revealed that happiness really is contagious. People who are happy or become happy significantly boost the chances that their friends will become happy. And the power of happiness can span up to 2 more degrees of separation, improving the mood of that person's husband, wife, brother, sister, friend, and even friends' friends. More surprisingly, these contagious effects have a lasting impact. One individual's happiness can affect another's for as much as a year. That happiness is more sustained than that which comes from a momentary financial gain. As James Fowler, co-author of the study, said, if your friend's friend becomes happy, that has a bigger impact on your being happy than putting an extra $5,000 in our pocket. Understanding emotional contagion is important for 2 reasons. First, understanding that your feelings of happiness or meaning can actually infect others helps to explain why some initiatives work and others don't. How did Barack Obama mobilize so many young people in the last U.S. presidential election, even as John McCain had a significantly muted effect, despite running mate Sarah Palin's brief interjection of high-energy drama? Why does Kiva, a revolutionary marketplace for microfinance lending to entrepreneurs, successfully empower so many, whereas a similarly spirited but considerably more rational product, Microplace, hasn't cultivated nearly as large a community or inspired similar brand recognition? Emotional contagion ripples through social networks, and it's important to understand the contagion of positive emotions that can lead others to help. Second, emotional contagion is pivotal because it underscores the importance of cultivating social good, which is often most resonant with happiness and meaning. Although this idea is not conventionally accepted yet, people don't have to give something away for free to do good. They can instead create a business that does good. Type social entrepreneur into Google and the 15 million hits reveal that this isn't a novel idea. The for-profit and not-for-profit worlds are merging, creating an opportunity for masses of happier people, people who have more time, drive more profits, and create greater good. Dragonfly mini case study, Salesforce and the 1% model. Mark Benioff, the CEO of Salesforce.com, a for-profit software company that pioneered an innovative, integrated, philanthropic model, 1% equity, 1% employees' time, and 1% profit in product donation, talks about the program's secondary gain. It has made our employees more fulfilled, more productive, and more loyal, he says. Our customers also have greater appreciation for us because of our philanthropic work. This is not why we do it, but the opportunity to work on something bigger together has positively affected our bottom line. Before we delve deeper, the relationship between happiness and money merits special attention. Our society's prevalent belief is that money will make us happy. However, the link between happiness and money is tenuous. Take the striking evidence that although income has steadily increased, roughly over the past 50 years in the United States, life satisfaction has remained virtually flat. A similar pattern is seen in data from other countries. Yet we continue to overestimate the impact of income on life satisfaction and spend our time and energy trying to grow our wealth. Why is it that money almost always lets us down? The answer might lie in the fact that human beings are said to have 3 basic needs in terms of their sense of self-worth. Competence, feeling that we are effective and able. Autonomy, feeling that our behavior is self-chosen and meaningful. and relatedness, feeling that we are connected to others. To the extent that a personal or professional goal does not address the aforementioned needs, one might perceive the rewards of achieving that goal as transient or lacking. Another line of work highlights the costs associated with the pursuit of material gains. Researchers studying self-esteem have identified that although there are obvious benefits associated with having high self-esteem, the pursuit of self-esteem is likely to interfere with relatedness, the sense of connection between ourselves and others. Self-regulation and emotional and physical health. For many, pursuing material gains equals pursuing self-esteem. However, personal wealth can in fact make people less happy and indeed often has a negative impact on their self-esteem. Social scientists frequently create wildly inaccurate forecasts of what really makes people happy because they mistakenly associate happiness with short and shallow rewards as opposed to long-lasting and deeper rewards. Increasingly, however, research suggests that individuals become consumers with the goal of becoming happy or getting happier, but that they rarely attain that goal through their purchases. The magazines are wrong. Retail therapy provides only fleeting pleasure and may in the end make you feel worse. It turns out that the adage money doesn't buy happiness isn't antiquated or false. The results of a recent experiment showed that spending money on others has a positive impact on happiness, much more so than spending money on oneself. The result was striking, given that the participants thought personal spending would make them happier than pro-social spending. Spending money on others has even been tied to reported states of well-being. Eudaimonia, or fundamental happiness, the result of an act of life, governed by intrinsic meaning, self-sacrifice, and self-improvement. Although it all sounds a little sanctimonious and conjures images of Gandhi and Mother Teresa, it's been illustrated by research too many times to simply ignore. The good news is that increasing and sustaining your happiness is possible, even easy, if you focus on others rather than yourself, and on time rather than money. Research has shown that even thinking about money can have a negative impact on happiness, but that focusing on time increases happiness because it increases interactions and connections with others. Not convinced? Consider the National Institutes of Health study that found that when people are encouraged to think of giving money to a charity, the brain areas usually associated with selfish pleasures are activated. Evolutionarily wired to be pro-social beings, we actually relish giving. The Dragonfly Effect connects us to others, to larger communities, and to social causes. There really is no better way to heighten relations and sense of purpose between ourselves and our surroundings, fulfill our psychological and emotional needs, and above all, create meaning in our lives than by cultivating social good. The Dragonfly Effect is your roadmap to doing something purposeful, thoughtful, and well-designed. Operating as social change in a box, it illustrates how synchronized ideas have been used effectively to create rapid transformations, and unveils the secrets to doing just that, step by step, so you can try it too. We'll share how to effectively tap into human behavior, and we'll explain how the four key principles, focus, grab attention, engage, and take action, work. Each of these principles is explored in its own chapter or wing. The heart of this book draws on studies on behavior change and the stories of individuals determined to make a difference. You'll gain insight from the founders of eBay's World of Good, storytellers from Pixar, leaders from Facebook, Twitter, and Google, as well as from social entrepreneurs, social media experts, and founders of nonprofit organizations that use the tools of social media to deliver positive change. We'll study efforts by individual social entrepreneurs who are using strategies like viral marketing to empower others to act on their behalf, as well as larger movements, such as how the Obama campaign created political change by leveraging social technology, how the organization Kiva.org encourages economic justice by making microloans easily available, how Nike deploys web tools to harness the volunteer efforts of their 34,000 employees, and how people like you can achieve a specific goal by using social technologies in ways you may have previously thought to be impossible. Tweeting isn't just to talk about what you ate this morning. Facebook isn't just for poking friends. You can harness these social technologies strategically and integratively toward a specific goal. To unpack the information in the text, we offer flowcharts, graphics, and sidebars. The Dragonfly Toolkit provides social media cheat sheets and boot camps specifically designed for people whose other skills rank ahead of technical proficiency. Dragonfly frameworks include new models that will help you implement your goal, and Dragonfly tips are simple and sometimes unconventional ideas inspired by consumer marketing research. Expert insights offer the wisdom of leaders in social media, entrepreneurship, filmmaking, technology, and more, showing how they have uniquely used social media to achieve spectacular results. Throughout, you'll find examples of how individuals and groups, on their own or on behalf of corporations, have used certain tools to create impact. Finally, throughout the Dragonfly Effect, we will apply concepts from design thinking. Design thinking takes a methodical approach to program and product development. It's taught as a way to create things that are better for the people who will ultimately use them, and helps get the creators over their unintentional biases and misconceptions. Design thinking encourages human-centric program development, hypothesis testing, and development of frequent, rapid prototypes. Time and again, initiatives falter because they're developed with the brand, organization, or cause, rather than the individual's needs, foremost in mind. People often tackle a challenge using preconceived notions of individuals' needs and solutions, but deep empathy doesn't guide their decision-making, and rapid prototyping is rarely used to solicit feedback. This flawed approach remains the norm in both business and social sectors. We believe that social challenges require systemic solutions that are grounded in individuals' needs. This is where many approaches falter, but where design thinking excels. The Dragonfly Effect is for anyone motivated to act on, propel, and accomplish social good. Whether you're an entrepreneur, an employee of a for-profit company, a volunteer at a nonprofit, or simply an individual trying to improve someone else's life, you can learn about the world of possibility available to you when you leverage social media appropriately. Ultimately, this book demonstrates that you don't need money or power to cause seismic social change. With energy, focus, and a good wireless connection, anything is possible. Creating lasting impact. An integral part of this book is our website, thedragonflyeffect.com, where you'll find a community of people like you, eager to do something worthwhile and share their experiences, tools, and resources. Via the website, we'll keep you updated on new ways to use the power of social technology to spark social change. The Dragonfly has long been a symbol of happiness, new beginnings, and change across cultures. Our hope is that the Dragonfly Effect continues to evolve with real-life activity and achievement it inspires and enables. The Dragonfly Body, the system that keeps it airborne. Samir Bhatia was always good with numbers. When he was in his 20s, the Stanford grad came up with an innovative algorithm that formed the foundation of his popular consumer barter marketplace, Monkey Bin. Young, smart, and distractingly good-looking, his friends, who called him Samba, adored his energy, optimism, and passion for pranks. By 31, the Silicon Valley entrepreneur was running a hot mobile gaming company and was newly married. Samir had everything going for him. Then, on a routine business trip to Mumbai, Samir, who worked out consistently and always kept himself in peak condition, started to feel under the weather. He lost his appetite and had trouble breathing. He wanted to blame the nausea, fatigue, and racing heartbeat on the humid, 100-degree monsoon weather, but deep inside, he knew something else was wrong. After a visit to the doctor at one of Mumbai's leading hospitals, blood tests showed that Samir's white blood cell count was wildly out of whack, and there were blasts in his cells. His doctor instructed him to leave the country as soon as possible to seek medical treatment closer to home in the U.S. Immediately upon entering the U.S., before he could even make it back to his hometown of Seattle, Samir was admitted to the Robert Wood Johnson University Hospital in New Jersey. He was diagnosed with acute myelogenous leukemia, AML, a cancer that starts in the bone marrow and is characterized by the rapid growth of abnormal white blood cells that interfere with the production of normal blood cells. AML is the most common acute leukemia affecting adults. Samir was facing the toughest challenge of his life. Half of all new cases of leukemia resulted in death, both in 2008 and today. But Samir was determined to beat the odds and get better. After a few months of chemotherapy and other pharmacological treatment, doctors told Samir that his only remaining treatment option would be bone marrow transplant, a procedure that requires finding a donor with marrow having the same human leukocyte antigens, HLA, as the recipient. Since tissue types are inherited, about 25 to 30% of patients are able to find a perfect match with a sibling. The remaining 70% must turn to the National Marrow Donor Program, NMDP, a national database with over 8 million registered individuals. Patients requiring a transplant are most likely to match with a donor of their own ethnicity. That wasn't a promising scenario for Samir, however. He had a rare gene from his father's side of the family that proved extremely difficult to match. After typing his brother, parents, and all of his cousins, the closest they got was a 2 out of 8 match. Even more worrisome was that of the millions of registered donors in the NMDP, only 1.4% were South Asian. As a result, the odds of Samir finding a perfect match were 1 in 20,000. A Caucasian person has a 1 in 15 chance. Worse, there were few other places to look. One would think that a match could easily be found in India, where Samir's family was originally from. After all, India is the world's second most populous country, with nearly 1.2 billion people. But India does not have a national organized bone marrow registry. Not a single match surfaced anywhere. People often ask what they can do to help in harrowing times. The answer is hard to find. Do you offer to drop off a meal? Lend an empathic ear? Such overtures are well-intentioned but rarely satiate the person who wants to help or the person who needs the help. Samir's circle of friends, a group of young and driven entrepreneurs and professionals, reacted to the news of Samir's diagnosis with a different perspective. We realized our choices were between doing something, anything, and doing something seismic, says Robert Chatwani, Samir's best friend and business partner. Collectively, they decided they would attack Samir's sickness as they would any business challenge. It came down to running the numbers. If they campaigned for Samir and held bone marrow drives throughout the country, they could increase the number of South Asians in the registry. The only challenge was that, to play the odds, they had to register 20,000 South Asians. They figured that this was the only way to find the match that would save his life. The only problem? Doctors told them that they had a matter of weeks to get the job done. Samir's friends and family needed to work fast, and they needed to scale. Their strategy? Tap the power of the internet and focus on the tight-knit South Asian community to get 20,000 South Asians into the bone marrow registry. Immediately. One of Robert's first steps was to write an email with a clear call to action. In the message, he did not ask for help. He simply told people what was needed of them. Because this was the first outbound message broadcasting Samir's situation, he spent hours agonizing over the email, ensuring that every word was perfect, and that the email itself was informative, personal, and direct. Finally, he was ready to send it out to a few hundred people in Samir's network of friends and professional colleagues. Dear friends, please take a moment to read this email. My friend, Samir Bhatia, has been diagnosed with acute myelogenous leukemia, AML, which is a cancer of the blood. He is in urgent need of a bone marrow transplant. Samir is a Silicon Valley entrepreneur, is 31 years old, and got married last year. His diagnosis was confirmed just weeks ago and caught us all by surprise, given that he has always been in peak physical condition. Samir, a Stanford alum, is known to many for his efforts in launching the American India Foundation, Project Dusty, Thai Chicago, a microfinance fund, and other causes focused on helping others. Now he urgently needs our help in giving him a new lease on life. He is undergoing chemotherapy at present but needs a bone marrow transplant to sustain beyond the next few months. Fortunately, you can help. Let's use the power of the net to save a life. Three things you can do. Number one, please get registered. Getting registered is quick and requires a simple cheek swab, 2 minutes of your time, and filling out some forms, 5 minutes of your time. Number three, learn more. To learn more, please visit nickmyers.com/helpsamir. The site includes more details on how to organize your own drive, valuable information about AML, plus facts on registering. Please visit helpvinay.org for more information on the cities where more help is needed. Another past success story from our community is that of Pia Awal. Please read about her successful fight against AML at matchpia.org. Thank you for getting registered to help Samir and others win their fight against leukemia and for helping others who may face blood cancers in the future. Truly, Robert. Robert sent the email to Samir's closest friends and business colleagues, about 400 to 500 members of their ecosystem, including fellow entrepreneurs, investors, South Asian relatives, and college friends. And that set of friends forwarded the email to their personal networks, and so on. Within 48 hours, the email had reached 35,000 people. Dragonfly Toolkit. How to write an email that inspires action and spurs change. Emails must be specific and action-oriented, informing people about the situation, telling them what they can do, and asking them to spread the message even further. Make it informative. Use email as an opportunity to educate your audience. Make it personal. Include accessible and specific details about the person or cause you're trying to help. Give someone a reason to care. Make it direct. Specifically ask the recipients for help. Tell them what you want them to do, and give them all the tools they need to do it easily. Samir's friends soon learned that yet another man in their ecosystem had recently been diagnosed with the same disease, Vinay Chakravarti, a Boston-based 28-year-old physician. Samir's friends immediately partnered with Team Vinay, an inspiring group of people who shared the same goal as Team Samir. Together, they harnessed Web 2.0, social media platforms, and services like Facebook, Google Apps, and YouTube to collectively campaign and hold bone marrow drives all over the country. Their goal was clear, and their campaign was underway. Within weeks, in addition to the national drives, Team Samir and Team Vinay coordinated bone marrow drives at over 15 Bay Area companies, including Cisco, Google, Intel, Oracle, eBay, PayPal, Yahoo, and Genentech. Volunteers in the East Coast started using the documents and collateral that the teams developed. After 11 weeks of focused efforts that included 480 bone marrow drives, 24,611 new people were registered. The teams recruited 3,500 volunteers, achieved more than 1 million media impressions, and garnered 150,000 visitors to their websites. "This is the biggest campaign we've ever been involved with," said Asia Bloom of the Asian American Donor Program. "Other patients might register maybe 1,000 donors. We never imagined that this campaign would blow up to this extent, nor did anyone imagine that this campaign would change the way future bone marrow drives are conducted." Perhaps the most critical result associated with the campaign, however, was the discovery of two matches, one for Vinay, one for Samir. In August 2007, only a few months after the kickoff of the campaign, Vinay found a close match. 2 weeks later, Samir was notified of the discovery of a perfect 10-for-10 match. Based on the timing of when the donors entered the database, it's believed that both Vinay and Samir's matches were a direct result of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.